Hi guys, continuing with our CAT papers discussion, we are today going to do CAT 2004 verbal NRC. We've already done half of the verbal NRC yesterday evening and we are going to do the second half today. So before we jump into it, here I'm Munira Lokhandwala, hi, and I'm Calcutta alumna, a serial 100th percentiler in CAT and a 99th percentiler in GMAT. I also have a CAT verbal book published by Wiley and available on Amazon. You can find me on the Earn Academy CrackCAT channel. You can also find me on the Earn Academy app. And to find me on the Earn Academy app, you should have the app, right? So please go to the Play Store, search for Earn Academy Learning app and install it. Within that, you have to enroll for the Plus CAT courses and get subscription, right? So we have a lot of Plus courses. Within that, we have, you know, courses with complete coverage. We have workshops, revisers. And we have a huge team of great educators, some of them 100 percentilers like myself. So you will definitely have a good range to choose from. Besides the Plus courses, we also have free courses and special classes as well. So guys, don't hesitate. Abhi bahut kam din bache hain CAT ke liye. Please go ahead and get subscription, right? Which subscription to go for? We can talk towards the end of the class. You can use my code MUNIRA10 to get 10% discount, right? So great, let's do the puzzle that I left y'all with yesterday. Yesterday, I had just given you all the puzzle without the options. Now today, we can look at the options also while solving, right? So if a town has 217 houses and some of these houses, right? So if I just denote houses with this circle, so these are your 2017 houses, right? Some of these houses have a laptop. So, you know, you can say that a small portion, they have laptop. Some of them have a smartphone and some of them have an Xbox. So here I have made three circles that are non-intersecting. Okay. Now, this is obviously impossible. I cannot have non-intersecting because if the laptop owners don't have a smartphone and, you know, neither do they have an Xbox, and similarly smartphones don't have laptops or Xbox, right? If I add up these three numbers, it is greater than 2017. So obviously they have to intersect, okay? So what do we have to find out? We have to find out X, which is the greatest possible value, okay, of people having all three, right? Greatest number of people having all three. And Y is the least number of people having all three. Okay. Now to find the greatest, guys. Okay. You want to find number of people having all three things, which means they have a laptop, they also have a smartphone, they also have an Xbox. Now, can I say that, you know, these all three people will be 2000? No, I cannot, right? Because already only 1820 have a laptop. Only 1651 have a smartphone. And only 1182 have an Xbox. So the number of people having all three has to be less than equal to the smallest of the three numbers, 1182. So then we can say that these guys who have an Xbox, because it's the smallest, right? They also have a smartphone. They also have a laptop. I cannot have 1651 having all three because number of Xboxes are only 1182, right? So this is not possible. That's why we pick up the smallest. So out of the three numbers, you have to pick up the smallest. And that, guys, will be the maximum value, 1182. Because I don't know anything else, right? I don't know whether there is a house that has all three. I don't know whether there is a house that has at least one. I don't know anything. So I can do whatever I want, hence to find the greatest, let's say these are the houses, these are the laptops, these are the smartphones, and finally inside that you will get your Xboxes. So this circle inside, this is your Xbox, okay? That's how you find the largest value. Now how do you find the smallest value? So to find the smallest value, you'll try and distribute them as much as possible. You will avoid their intersection. Okay, so to minimize all three, you will maximize everything else. So you'll maximize at least one, right? You'll maximize exactly two also. And if there's anybody left, then you will say, okay, now this has to be at least three. Okay. So first of all, let's add up these three numbers. When you add up 1820 and 1651 and 1182, you get 3, and then 2, 5 and 8, right? You get 5. Then you subtract 1 from here. Sorry, you add 1 here. And here you get 6. And finally, 4, 6, 5, 3 is what you get. Now, when we add these three numbers, guys, we're actually adding people who have laptop, who have smartphone, and who have Xbox. People who have exactly one item are counted once. People who have exactly two items are counted twice. Now, there are 2017 houses. So, we'll say these guys are counted exactly. All of these guys have everything and they are counted exactly twice. So, if I find this value, it is 4034. So, if I subtract 4034 from 4653, then the remaining 619, these are the guys who have at least three. Because I need to count somebody three times. Even if I count all these 2017 guys two times, I'm still only reaching 4034 when in the addition I'm reaching 4653. So some guys were counted three times, right? And the answer hence is option B, 619. Oops, no, sorry, 619 is not the answer. I have to find 1182 minus 619. This is what I need to find out. So this answer, guys, is 563. Option C. Not option D, right? Because you have to find out X minus Y. X is 1182 and Y is 619. Right? Now let's look at some verbal. So yesterday we did four passages, right? And we did around 17 questions from the four passages. Today, one passage is still remaining. And then we will do a lot of other questions. As I have told you yesterday itself, guys, that 2004 had 50 questions, out of which 19 questions are no longer applicable for us because they were grammar, fill in the blanks, usage, right? So I have not used those 19 questions. We are working with the remaining 31 questions. As you all are already aware by now, the CAT is no longer a 3-hour paper. It is a 2-hour paper. Okay? So, this has to go up, your speed of attempting. Final thing before we start reading, guys, iska PDF description box mein hai. Please go download it, read it from there, and then you look at the video solutions. Okay? So, throughout human history, the leading causes of death have been infection and trauma. Modern medicine has scored significant victories against both. And the major causes of ill health and death are now chronic degenerative diseases such as A, B, C, D, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so there are some, you know, like heart failure and cancer. Okay. These have a long latency period before symptoms appear and a diagnosis is made. It follows that the majority of apparently healthy people are pre-ill. So we may already be ill, but we don't know it. Are these conditions inevitably degenerative? A truly preventive medicine that focused on the pre-ill, analyzing the metabolic errors which lead to clinical illness, might be able to correct them before the first symptom. Genetic risk factors are known for all the chronic degenerative diseases and are important to the individuals who possess them. At the population level, however, migration studies confirm that these illnesses are linked for the most part to lifestyle factors. Okay. So, preventive medicine can focus and make us perhaps better, right? So, But because there are genetic risk factors also, and at the population level, there are lifestyle factors also, primarily exercise, smoking, and nutrition. Nutrition is the easiest of these to change and the most versatile tool for affecting the metabolic changes needed to tilt the balance away from disease. Many national surveys reveal that malnutrition is common in developed countries. This is not the calorie and or micronutrient deficiency associated with developing nations. So see, when I'm talking about developing nations, I'm talking about nations that are not very well off. So obviously there, the poor will have less to eat, right? And that is the calorific deficiency. They're just eating less. And this happens in developing nations. But there is multiple micronutrient depletion, usually combined with a balance, which means that there is no deficit or excess, right? And that is type B nutrition, malnutrition. So this happens in developed countries, that you have enough to eat, but you're eating the wrong things. The incidence and severity of type B malnutrition will be shown to be worse if newer micronutrient groups such as the essential fatty acids, xanthophylls, and flavonoids are included in the surveys. So the type B malnutrition just worsens if you look at all categories. Commonly ingested levels of these micronutrients seem to be far too low in many developed countries. So we eat very less of these micronutrients. There is now considerable evidence that type B malnutrition is a major cause of chronic degenerative disease. Okay, so it is the major cause. If this is the case, then it is logical to treat such diseases not with drugs but with multiple micronutrient repletion or pharmaconutrition. This can take the forms of pills and capsules, nutraceuticals, or food formats known as functional foods. This approach has been neglected hitherto because it is relatively unprofitable for drug companies. The products are hard to patent and it is a strategy which does not sit easily with modern medical interventionism. Okay, so when you have pills and all, companies ka fayda hota hai. Having the right sort of functional food se, company ka koi fayda nahi hota hai. They cannot patent it. So, you know, that's why this is not well marketed. Over the last 100 years, the drug industry has invested huge sums in developing a range of subtle and powerful drugs to treat the many diseases we are subject to. Medical training is couched in pharmaceutical terms, and this approach has provided us with an exceptional range of therapeutic tools in the treatment of disease and in acute medical emergencies. However, the pharmaceutical model has also created an unhealthy dependency culture in which relatively few of us accept responsibility for maintaining our own health. So a lot of subtle drugs are made to combat diseases, right? But this has also led to an unhealthy dependency culture in which we don't accept responsibility for our own health. Instead, right, we look at health professionals who themselves may not know enough about health maintenance or disease prevention. One problem for supporters of this argument is the lack of the right kind of hard evidence. Okay, so we don't have enough hard evidence on what nutrients help. We have a wealth of epidemiological data linking dietary factors to health profiles and a great deal of information on mechanism, how food factors interact with the biochemistry. But almost all intervention studies with micronutrients, with the notable exception of omega-3 fatty acids, have so far produced conflicting or negative results. So we don't have very clear studies that say ki micronutrients lene se bhala hota hai, right? The results are conflicting or negative. In other words, our science appears to have no predictive value. Does this invalidate the science, or are we simply asking the wrong questions? Based on pharmaceutical thinking, most intervention studies have attempted to measure the impact of a single micronutrient on the incidence of disease. The classical approach says that if you give a compound formula to test subjects and obtain positive results, you cannot know which ingredient is exerting the benefit. So you must test each ingredient individually. But in the field of nutrition, this does not work. Each intervention on its own will hardly make enough difference to be measured. The best therapeutic response must therefore combine micronutrients to normalize our internal physiology. So do we need to analyze each individual's nutritional status and then tailor a formula specifically for him or her? While we do not have the resources to analyze millions of individual cases, there is no need to do so. The vast majority of people are consuming suboptimal amounts of most micronutrients, and most of the micronutrients concerned are very safe. Accordingly, a comprehensive and universal program of micronutrient support is probably the most cost-effective and safest way of improving the general health of the nation. So the last paragraph says, you know, that the results are conflicting or negative, and this explains why. Generally, when you do a scientific experiment, you only change one thing at a time. But one nutrient itself will not make too much of a difference. So a combination of nutrients should be given so that you get normalize your internal physiology. And this can be given to almost everyone because we are having suboptimal amounts of most micronutrients. So if there is a comprehensive and universal program of micronutrient support, then it will be a cost-effective and safest way of improving the general health of the nation. So for example, right, if you have calcium but you don't have it, vitamin D, then your body cannot use the calcium. So, you know, vitamin D and calcium go together. I'm just giving an example from outside. That's why I'm relating it in my head. Right? So great, let's look at questions. The author recommends micronutrient repletion for large-scale treatment of chronic degenerative diseases. So, you know, there are two places where this comes up. One is right here. Nutrition is the easiest to change. Are linked for the most part to lifestyle factors, exercise, smoking, and nutrition. Nutrition is the easiest to change. And it also comes here that type B malnutrition is a major cause of chronic degenerative diseases. If this is the case, then we should treat. So between the two, here is a stronger case for why we are looking at micronutrient deficiency, right? And micronutrient repletion. So it is not relatively easy to manage, guys. It is not option one. Option one is mentioned in the beginning, but the major reason is that micronutrient deficiency is the cause of these diseases. Taking micronutrient-based treatment plans to suit individual is not necessary. Tailoring, right? Is because all of us have deficiency. That's what he is saying, right? That most of us here, the vast majority are consuming suboptimal, less than required. That's why we should all have it. So here we are looking at very likely to give inconsistent? No, then why would we not tailor, right? Most people are consuming three's best. It is a classical, not suited to micro, not at all, right? General classical approach is not suited, but that's not the reason why we are not tailoring. It is not cost, nothing about cost is mentioned, right? Answer is option three. So for this question, the answer is two. Next question, the answer is three, right? Type B malnutrition is a serious concern in developed countries because. So as we said, right, in developing countries, they eat less. But in developed countries, you don't eat the right kind of food. Okay. So the reason is not about the developing countries, right? They are two different things. So A is not possible. You're talking about why it's a concern in developed countries. So what happens in developing countries is out of scope. The reason it is a problem is because it leads to disease. So two is looking good. Because pharmaceutical companies are not producing drugs to treat this condition. No, but this is not a condition. This is a cause that leads to illness and death. That is why three is out. National surveys on malnutrition do not include newer micronutrient groups. If it includes it, this will be worse. That's what it's saying. That if you include right new micronutrients, then the incidence will be worse. So it's not as if not including is a problem, right? So your answer is option two. Why are a large number of apparently healthy people deemed pre-ill? Because we may have one looks good. We do not know our risk factors. This also is mentioned that people don't know the risk factors, right? Are known and are important at the population, right? It is linked to these, but we don't know which genetic risk factors we have. They suffer from type B. No, this is not why we are pre-ill. we may suffer, but this is not the reason. There's a lengthy latency period associated with chronically degenerative diseases. So prima facie, 1, 2, and 4, they all look good. But this just says ki this is why we may have chronic degenerative diseases. This doesn't give the cause. So that's why 1 is out. Between lengthy latency period and not knowing own genetic risk factors, right? Once we know our genetic risk factors, we'll be able to treat ourselves. So it is not the length of time that leads us to become ill. The length of time is a diagnosis name hota hai. It is our genetic risk factors that make us ill. So answer is option 2. You have to understand the question very clearly. Okay, why are we pre-ill? We are not pre-ill because of the length of the period. We are pre-ill because we have risk factors that makes us predisposed towards diseases. Right? So answer is option 2. So your this question answer is 2, and this also the answer is 2, right? Great, jumble paragraphs. So again I'll remind you that in 2004 CAT some questions were half marks, right? There were half mark questions. Then some questions were 1 marks. And you had some questions that were 2 marks. So the full RC that we had, 21 questions, they were all 1 markers. And these also are 1 markers. The 3 parajumbles that we are going to do, this is a 1 mark question. So this is not a difficult one. If you have tried it already, you would be knowing. Right? You have 2 neighbors never fought with each other. Fights involving 3 have been recorded, but the status was unknown. Status was unknown. They pushed or grappled only with the intruder. Who is they? It is the 2 neighbors. If you see, we recorded 17 cases in which a resident that was fighting an intruder was joined by an immediate neighbor and ally. The 2 neighbors never fought each other. So if you see, there's a clear link of B, A, C. If you start looking at options, you can see that there's only 1 option. Let's read C, E. We therefore tracked 268 intruder males until we saw them fighting a resident male. So there was this thing where the status was unknown and therefore has to follow that. Because we didn't know, we tracked down. So we start with B, which is a good introduction. Right, that the status of participants was unknown. We therefore tracked 268 intruder males. Right, in 17 cases, a neighbor joined them. The neighbors never fought each other. They pushed or grappled only with the intruder. It's perfect. Very clear rationale, very clear logic. Right? Next question. In the West, Allied forces had fought their way through southern Italy as far as Rome. In June 1944, Germany's military position in World War II appeared hopeless. In Britain, the task of amassing the men and materials for the liberation of northern Europe had been completed. Red Army was poised to drive the Nazis back through Poland. The situation on the Eastern Front was catastrophic. So East, West, everywhere there are issues with the war for Germany. So this has to be the introduction. B has to begin. Right? And then you want to get E, East and West together. Right? The situation on the Eastern Front was catastrophic. And the Red Army, which is the Russian army, Russia is to the east of Germany. Right? So E, D ka link hai. The situation was catastrophic. Why? Because Red Army was poised and in the West, the Allied forces were coming. So you have to have B, E, D, the East for 2 things, right? And then in the West and finally C. So you are looking at the second option, B, E, D, A, C, right? Next. He felt justified in bypassing Congress. Who is he? At times, he was fighting the entire Congress. Who is he? Bush. Oh, Bush. Bush felt he had a mission. Okay. Bush was not fighting just the Democrats. Representatives, democracy is a messy business. And a CEO of the White House, which is basically the president, right, does not like a legislature of second guessers and time wasters. So we are looking at यहाँ पे जॉर्ज बुश इन फैक्ट इज इंट्रोड्यूस्ड सो यू ई हैज टू बिगिन द होल प्रॉब्लम इज इंट्रोड्यूस्ड हियर राइट दैट रिप्रेजेंटेटिव्स डेमोक्रेसी इज अ मेसी बिजनेस सीईओ डज नॉट लाइक लेजिस्लेचर राइट सो ई हैज टू बिगिन इफ यू जस्ट सी दिस पार्ट के ई हैज टू बिगिन यू कैन सी दैट देयर इज ओनली वन पॉसिबिलिटी फॉर बट एनीवेज बुश फेल्ट ही हैड अ मिशन टू रिस्टोर पावर ऑन द प्रेसिडेंसी राइट एंड Bush was not just fighting the Democrats. At times, he was fighting the entire Congress. There's a very clear DB link also. But DB link is everywhere. Right? So it has to be that Bush felt he had a mission, right? So that continues, that introduces Bush. And then you will finally have the A, that he felt justified. So A explains B. There is a BA link. So there's a clear DBA link. And C has to begin before these, and E is the introduction. So fourth option, right? Now, para summaries. Again, guys, this is the one marker para summary. All these three jumble paras that we did were one markers. These para summaries are also one mark questions. So let's read this. The human race is spread all over the world from the polar regions to the tropics. The people of whom it is made up eat different kinds of food, partly according to the climate in which they live and partly according to the kind of food which their country produces. In hot climates, meat and fat are not much needed, but in the Arctic regions, they seem to be very necessary for keeping up the heat of the body. Thus, in India, people live chiefly on different kinds of grains, eggs, milk, or sometimes fish and meat. In Europe, people eat more meat and less grain. In the Arctic regions where no grains and fruits are produced, the Eskimos and other races live almost entirely on meat and fish. So the thing that they're trying to say is that what we eat is made up of two things. Climate, whether it is hot or cold, right? If it is hot, we don't need too much meat. But if it's cold, we need it. And then what is made there? What is produced there? And then examples are given about heat, about what is made, right? So food eaten by people in different regions depends on climate and produce perfect and varies from meat and fish in the Arctic to predominantly grains in the tropics. It is predominantly grains. It is not only grains. In the winter, we still eat fish sometimes. So one is looking good because it is mild. It says predominantly and not always. So one is looking good. Hot climates require people to eat grains, while cold regions require people to eat meat and fish. Is fair, it is, there's nothing wrong with it, but it is incomplete. It just talks about climate. It does not talk about what is produced. There are two things. So it is incomplete, and that's why the second option is out. In hot countries, people eat mainly grains, while in the Arctic, they eat meat and fish because they cannot grow grains. Whether they can or cannot grow grains, right? That we don't know. It's a little out of syllabus. And nothing about climate is mentioned. Hot countries bola hai. Thoda, right? But the fact that it's based on hot and cool and production is not clearly mentioned. So three is incorrect. While people in Arctic regions like meat and fish and those in hot regions like India prefer mainly grains, they have to change what they eat depending on the local climate and the local produce. So liking ka kuch baat hua nahi hai ke what do we like? It is about what we have to eat. There's a difference between liking, where we have a choice, and having, where we don't have a choice. So yahan who likes what, not mentioned. So four is wrong because it talks about liking. So best answer here, guys, is option one. Nothing wrong with it. It's perfect. Right? That's your answer. Second question for para summaries, one marker. You seem that first to take no notice of your school fellows, or rather to set yourself against them because they were strangers to you. They knew as little of you as you did of them. This would have been the reason for their keeping aloof from you as well, which you would have felt as a hardship. Learn never to conceive a prejudice against others because you know nothing of them. It is bad reasoning and makes enemies of half of the world. Do not think ill of them till they behave ill to you, and then strive to avoid the faults which you see in them. This will disarm their hostility sooner than pique or resentment or complaint. So you have to avoid the faults that you see in them. Right? Do not think ill of them till they behave ill with you. So having a good idea of what is spoken about, yeah? Don't have prejudice. Because you are aloof, you may not know people, right? All this you should have in your head very clearly. Then we can start looking at options. The discomfort you felt with your school fellows was because both sides knew little of each other. Fair enough, right? Yahan pe kuch hai. But it's also primarily because you took no notice of each other, right? You should not complain unless you find others prejudiced against you. You should not complain till you are avoiding the faults, right? Till you are disarming them by avoiding the faults. So when you should complain is not given very clearly. If you see, right? Learn never to conceive. It's bad reasoning. This will disarm. But sooner than pique or resentment or complaint, when you should complain is not given. So one is incorrect. The discomfort was because both sides knew little of each other. Fair enough. Avoid prejudice and negative thoughts till you encounter bad behavior from others. Correct. Right? Never have a prejudice till they speak ill of you. And then win them over. Disarm their hospitality by shunning the faults you have observed. Clearly theirs. Last line. So two looks good. You encountered hardship amongst your school fellows. Where is the hardship? It's just that you are aloof and you would have felt it as a hardship. Not that you actually encountered any hardship. You should learn not to make enemies because of your prejudices, irrespective of their behavior towards you. No, their behavior makes sense. You should only think ill until they are ill with you. So this is also wrong. Hardship is also wrong. This third question not working out, third option. You encountered hardship amongst your school fellows because you did not know them well. Again, encountered hardship. You must have feeling it's a hardship and encountering hardship, different things. You should learn not to make enemies because of your prejudices unless they behave badly with you. This is also okay. The problem is this encountering hardship. Best is second, which is using a milder word, discomfort, that you feel. You don't encounter hardships. Right? Great. Now we move on to para summaries that and para jumbles, right? That are 2 marks. So here, this para jumbles in the actual CAT paper was for 2 marks. So let's read this. But this does not mean that death was the Egyptians' only preoccupation. Even papyri come mainly from pyramid temples. Most of our traditional sources of information about the Old Kingdom are monuments of the rich like pyramids and tombs. Even this come mainly from pyramid temples. So there's a good link here, right, with CB. Most of our sources, papyri is basically that thin parchment paper on which things are written. It's like paper. So even they come from pyramid temples. So if I look at the CB link, I can eliminate second option. I can eliminate fourth option. Houses in which ordinary Egyptians lived have not been preserved. And when most people died, they were buried in simple graves. We know infinitely more about the wealthy people than we do about the ordinary people, as most monuments are made for the rich. So you see, this talks about how we know more about rich people, and this talks about how houses of normal Egyptians were not preserved. So there's a clear ED link, which means we are looking at the third option. So you have ED, we know infinitely more about the wealthy people. Why? Because houses were not preserved of the normal people. right? Most of our information also comes from the rich, even papyri. But this does not mean that death was the Egyptians' only preoccupation. So this is a good conclusion, and there's nothing else here besides death. So this cannot come in the middle. It has to come at the end. That's why your answer is option B. Next question. Experts such as Larry Burns, head of research at GM, reckon that only such a half-hearted leap will allow the world to cope with the mass motorization that will one day come to China or India. Such a full-hearted leap. Sorry, not half-hearted. Such a full, kaha pe hai ye? I need to see what comes before A. But once hydrogen is being produced from biomass or extracted from, the way will be open for a huge reduction in cargo emissions from the whole system. So this looks nice. I should have a BA. In theory, once all the bugs have been sorted out, fuel cells should deliver better total fuel economy than any existing engines. Engines, okay. That is twice as good as the internal combustion engine, but only 5 percentage points better than a diesel hybrid. So this is talking about actual numbers. Some number is twice as good. Where is the number, guys? The number is in E. So there's a very clear ED link. So I can eliminate second option. I can eliminate fourth option. So now let's look at the ED link. Allowing for the resources needed to extract hydrogen from hydrocarbon, the fuel cell has an efficiency of 30%, right? That is twice as good as the internal combustion engine, but only 5 percentage points better than a diesel hybrid. But once hydrogen is being produced, there is such a full-hearted leap is needed. So you have E, D, B, and A. And then your C is a good introduction. Hence, answer here is 1. Next question. Now, these para summaries are 2 markers. We did 2 para jumbles that were 2 markers, now 3 para summaries. So, totally, these 5 questions, guys, are 10 marks, 2 marks each, 5 into 2. Okay. Let's see. Local communities have often come in conflict with agents trying to exploit resources at a faster pace for an expanding commercial industrial economy. Right? So local communities have conflicts with people who want to expand very fast. Okay? More often than not, such agents of resource intensification are given preferential treatment by the state through the grant of generous long leases over mineral or fish stocks, for example, or the provision of raw material at an enormously subsidized price. So these outside agents are given preferential treatment with the injustice so compounded that, you know, we can't, local communities cannot fight now. Local communities at the receiving end of this process have no recourse except direct action, resisting both the state and outside exploiters through a variety of protest techniques. This struggle might perhaps be seen as a manifestation of a new class, kind of class conflict. What is a class conflict? Local communities and outside agents. Ye dono class ka jhagda ho raha. They get a resource grant, the government helps them, and so local communities have to fight the state and the outside exploiters. A new kind of class conflict arises from preferential treatments given to agents of resource intensification by the state, which the local community sees as unfair. This is unfair, but the local community has a bigger problem with the exploitation of resources. We can't say that this is the reason why the local community has a problem. So one is wrong. It's giving a different reason. The grant of long leases to agents of resource intensification for an expanding commercial leads to direct protest from the local community, which sees it as unfair. Okay, so there is direct protest, but the protest is also against the state, not only against the agents. Right? So this looks okay, we'll keep it right now. Let's see the third one. Preferential treatment given by the state for an expanding exacerbates injustice and leads to direct protest from them, resulting in a new type of class conflict. So this is very good. Right? We are saying that the, you know, expanding commercial, that's the reason injustice or worse ho jata hai. and there are direct protests, and there is a class conflict because of this. The problem with B is that you give the long leases, and that leads to direct resources. No, it's actually the resource exploitation. This is here very clearly given. Okay, so 3 is good. 3 is better than 2. Local communities have no option but to protest against agents of resource intensification and create a new type of class conflict when they are given raw material at subsidized prices, long leases, or the provision of raw material at an enormously subsidized. And this is given to the agents, not to local communities. So when they say that who creates the new type of class conflict, local communities, when they are given, who's they? It's not the local community. So this actually changes meaning. So 4 is out. Answer is the third option. Next. Although almost all climate scientists agree that Earth is gradually warming, they have long been of two minds about the process of rapid climate shifts within larger periods of change. Some have speculated that the process works like a giant oven or freezer, warming or cooling at the same time. Others think that shifts occur on opposing schedules in the northern and southern hemisphere, like exaggerated seasons. Recent research in Germany examining climate patterns in the southern hemisphere at the end of the last ice age strengthens the idea that warming and cooling occurs at alternate times in the two hemispheres. A more definite answer to this debate will allow scientists to better predict when and how quickly the next climate shift will happen. So there are two schools of thought. One is that saath mein this occurs at the same time. And then there is that their opposing schedule in the north and the southern. And the Germany guys are agreeing with the opposing schedules in the two hemispheres. If you have a clear answer, then we can know when the next climate shift will happen. Okay, so scientists have been unsure. Happen all at once or on opposing schedules, research will help find a definite answer and better predict climate shifts in future. Okay, so it's not whether the rapid shift is happening together or on opposing schedules. It is also about how the process works. Right? Better predict climate shifts in the future, and it is not just when, but how quickly also, how soon. So this is in some sense incomplete. Scientists have been unsure whether rapid shifts in the Earth's climate happen all at once or opposing schedules. Okay. Finding a definitive answer will help them predict better, will help them better predict climate shifts in future. So what is the difference between the first two options? Research will help, Rehan Likha, and finding a definitive answer will help them. So you have to go back and check a more definitive answer to this debate. It is the definitive answer. So one goes off because it's not research. We'll keep 2 right now. Research in Germany will help scientists find a definitive answer. Where is research in Germany? Germany has already found one answer. So 3 is wrong. More research rather than debates on warming or cooling. There are no debates happening. And it's not more research, you need a definitive answer. So the only thing that talks about definitive answer clearly is the second option. Last question. You have this person who is a very well-known Greek philosopher, and it's always confusing on how to pronounce this name. So many vowels that to T-Z-S-C-H. It is pronounced Nietzsche. Nietzsche. Okay. So modern bourgeois society said Nietzsche was decadent and enfeebled, a victim of the excessive development of the rational faculties at the expense of will and instinct. So today's society is weak and decadent, means prone to luxury. It's a victim of the excessive rational faculty sabka develop hota hai, and will and instinct is going down. Against the liberal rationalist stress on the intellect, Nietzsche urged recognition of the dark, mysterious world of instinctual desires, the true forces of life. He's saying instinctual desire is the true force of life. Smother the will, excessive intellectual smother the will, excessive intellectualizing, and you destroy the spontaneity that sparks cultural creativity and ignites a zest for living. The critical and theoretical outlook destroyed the creative instincts. For man's manifold potential to be realized, he must forego relying on the intellect and nurture again the instinctual roots of human existence. Right? So for our potential to be realized, we must stop looking at the intellect and nurture our instinctual desires, our will, and our instinct. So urges the decadent to forego intellect and give importance to creative instincts. Looks good. We'll keep this right now. Okay. You know, you should let go of the intellect and give importance to creative instincts. But see, first of all, this is extreme. Keep in mind, it says let go of the intellect. Whereas what this says is we must forego relying on the intellect. It's not saying, okay, please leave your intelligence. It's saying, please don't rely on intelligence, right? So one is extreme, but as of right now, it is okay. Nietzsche urges the decadent to smother the will. No. In fact, he's saying that society smothers the will, right? He's saying we should let our will be free. We should ignite a zest for living. So this, guys, is wrong. Nietzsche criticizes the intellectuals for enfeebling by not nurturing man's... No, the intellectuals are not enfeebling. We are victims. We are doing it ourselves. So three is again wrong. Nietzsche blames excessive intellectualization for the decline of modern society and suggests nurturing creative instincts instead. Between 1 and 4, guys, this is less extreme. 1 is saying let go of the intellect only, which doesn't make sense, right? So hence our answer is option 4. Right? Great. I hope you like this discussion. Current CAT questions, guys, is very, very close to this format. So let's look at your bonus puzzle. An Anderson number is a positive integer less than 1000 with the property that k square ends with a digit or digits of k. For example, 25 is an Anderson number because 625 ends with 25. But 75 is not because 5625 does not end with 75. If s is the sum of all even Anderson numbers, what is the sum of the digits of s? So it's a slightly difficult question, but guys, please do give it a shot, right? Here is your reading assignment. OHG is a very good author, and if possible, you can read a book by him. So they're slightly difficult to read. This actually talks about his book, and it reviews the book Late Essays, okay? So please do give this a good read. Guardian articles are reasonably well written. I'll see you again in the evening when we start off with CAT 2004 DILM, right? You can also find me on Unacademy, guys. So please, I know okay, YouTube pe you get a lot of stuff, and why should you go on the app? Once you go on the app, you'll realize that the environment is tailored strictly for you CAT aspirants to do well, right? So it's completely focused towards learning. There are no distractions, right? You have live classes, live doubt-solving sessions. Every fourth lecture is a doubt-solving session. You interact with educators. You have live polls, leaderboard, test series analysis. Right now also, there's an All-India Championship test going on with very good test series. So guys, don't hesitate. Please go ahead and subscribe, right? If you're focused on CAT 20, please look at the 12-month subscription. If you're confused between CAT 20 and 21, then you can look at the two-year subscription. Use the code MUNIRA10 to get a heavy discount. And I will see you soon. Take care. Bye-bye.